Easter day begins with a journey. It was the Sunday morning, and as the sun was rising, these two women, both with the same name, Mary and Mary Magdalene, they were travelling to see the place where Jesus had been buried on the Friday evening just before sunset. Now, when you're reading a story, it's like an invitation to come along. So if you're reading the Harry Potter stories, you're invited to join in the magical universe of wizardry. And it's no less the case with true stories. If you're reading of Anne Frank's diary, for example, you're invited to come and share the thoughts and experiences of a little girl involved in the midst of a horrific war. Well, for us this morning, we're here to look at the eyewitness biographies of Jesus, and we're invited to enter into the true story. We are invited to join these two women on their journey to the tomb, to see what they saw and experience what they experienced. Three directions for us to go in as we become participants in the story. First of all, come and be amazed. When was the last time you were amazed, I wonder? Well, two women on their way to visit someone's grave. In the meantime, there's an earthquake. There's a man dressed in white who comes down from heaven, and his appearance is so bright it's described as being like lightning. Are you amazed yet? Well, this man, this angel, he very simply walks up to the tomb where the dead body of Jesus has been placed. Without any fuss, he rolls back this massive heavy stone and he sits down on the stone. The soldiers who were on guard, they were amazed. They were so amazed by this, they became unconscious. They were men who were not easily shocked by anything. They'd been in many battles and involved in many gruesome things. But to see something like this, such a supernatural occurrence, it was just too much for them. It was too overwhelming. They faint and become unconscious. Now, there are two extreme reactions to amazing phenomenon like this. And those two reactions are gullibility and skepticism. So gullible people will believe anything. It's just been April Fool's Day, and gullible people will believe anything that is put out there on April Fool's Day, whether it's Scottish scientists who have been growing sausages on trees, or ITV's new reality show Dove Island, where they get a load of exotic birds and shove them all on an island to leave them and let love blossom. Whilst gullible people will believe just about everything, sceptical people will believe nothing. The sceptic is an expert at doubting even the most blatantly obvious facts that are put before them. But what helps both the gullible person and the sceptic to be truly grounded is the evidence of the facts. Evidence will convince the sceptic, and evidence will ground the gullible. So look, there's plenty of evidence for this event of Jesus coming back to life. The Bible itself is the greatest piece of evidence. True, it was written to try and persuade people to believe in Jesus, but it was also written within the lifetime of the events themselves. So people who witnessed these events were still alive when the Bible was written. They couldn't just make up what happened. But what are the other options? There's no way Jesus could have just fainted and revived himself. He would have been too weak to break out of the tomb. It couldn't have been the wrong tomb, because it was very obvious which tomb it was, not least because of the guards which marked the right tomb, but also because it was owned by one of the followers of Jesus. As for stealing the body, well, there's a lot to overcome. The elite soldiers on guard, the heavy sealed door, it would be a massive operation. And the only people with motive were his followers, and they were scared witless and in hiding by this stage. Then there's the fact that this changed the lives of his followers. They had been scared and in hiding, but now they were bold and courageous, willing to die for their claim that Jesus was alive. Look, I could go on. There's plenty more pieces of evidence. But this is not merely a fact-finding experience. The whole point of these facts are to amaze us. So I wonder, are you willing to be amazed by this moment in history? When a man who claimed to be God, a man who claimed to have power over death, he broke out of his grave and was alive again. Does that amaze you? Well, the second direction for us to go in, as well as to be amazed, is to come and be comforted. The two Marys, they make it to the tomb. By this time, the resurrection has happened. Jesus has come back to life and has come out of the tomb. And all that's left are a few unconscious soldiers and this angel who is sat on the tomb door with the empty tomb behind him. Now, you might be amazed, but you might also be terrified at that. And that is the case with these women. And so the angel begins his conversation in verse 5 with the words, "Do not be afraid." But here's the thing. What would they be afraid of? Of course, they're going to be afraid at seeing an angel. Almost everyone in the Bible who encounters an angel reacts with fear and gets told by that angel not to be afraid. It's more than that, though. They are going to be afraid at what has happened to Jesus. Remember, they're not expecting to find anything out of the ordinary. They're expecting to find the dead body of the one that they loved dearly and gave up everything to follow. They had their great hopes of him being the promised king, and these have now been dashed by his untimely execution. He's dead and buried, and that's all they're expecting to find. They weren't expecting him to return to life again. So immediately there's going to be fears of what has happened to the body. What has gone on here? The facts inform their fears and bring comfort. And so the angel tells them he's not here. He gives them the facts, and those facts inform their fears. Though he was dead, he has come back to life again. They're invited to see the place where his body was laid. So the facts are to bring comfort. But then comes a promise-building expectation. It's going to get even better. And that brings even more comfort to these two Marys in fear. This promise, this expectation that they are given is that they are going to see him. As they're given this task of going to tell the others that he's alive again, so they will see him in this place that they know so well, Galilee. Now, we haven't had an experience like this one, have we? But that doesn't mean we can't know what fear is. We all know what fear is. We're all familiar with it. I wonder, what are your greatest fears? I imagine a lot of our fears have something to do with death. We fear our own lives coming to an end prematurely. We fear leaving loved ones behind. We fear losing those that we love. And how those fears have been magnified over the course of the pandemic. For my own part, there have been several occasions when I've woken up in the middle of the night feeling hot, and so have managed to convince myself that I've caught the virus. Fear is lingering around the corner. Our fear is never too far away from us at any moment. Those fears that we have, they're in conflict with our hopes, aren't they? We hope for long lives. We hope to have those we love around us into our old age. But death severs our hopes, which is one of the reasons why we fear death. Likewise for these Marys, their hopes had been dashed by death as their hopes for a promised king were cut short when he was killed. But the comfort here for the women in their fear is that death was not the end for Jesus. He was alive again. The great comfort for us is that if we belong to Jesus, then just as death was not the end for him, so it will not be the end for us either. As he was raised again to life after death, so those who follow him will be raised to life after death with him. Even now, when the Christian dies, their soul goes to be with Jesus in heaven. But at some point in the future, Jesus will return to this earth to make his permanent home here and to make this world a perfect place. And at that point, death will be reversed so that those who belong to Jesus will be physically raised up again to receive eternal life and eternal bodies to enjoy this eternal new creation. The greatest comfort you can have in life is to know that death is not the end for you, and that in Jesus you will experience life that death cannot overcome, and so that there is a future waiting for you in the new creation. I want you to notice verse 8 though. So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy. These women are still afraid. There's still a sense of fear to them, but they are filled with joy. Now, knowing this future hope that we have with Jesus, it shouldn't make us glib about death. Death is still pretty devastating, but it will fill us with joy in the face of death. So we can come and be amazed. We can come to be comforted. Thirdly, we are invited to come and be worshippers. As the women run off, they're going to do the job that they've been given, which is to tell the others about the news that Jesus is alive. As we've said, they're still fearful, but they're also filled with joy. There's a buzz about them, a skip in their step. There's an air of excitement, a deep-rooted happiness that they now have because of their hopes that Jesus is alive. And then he is there. Jesus is right there in front of them. They didn't need to wait until they got to Galilee even. He's come to them. And it's almost amusing how Jesus simply says, "Greetings," as if it's just another day, as if him standing in front of them alive when he should be dead is just a normal thing. But it's the response of these two Marys that we need to see. In verse 9, it tells us how they grasped his feet and worshipped him. Now, that might seem a weird response to us. I can't say I've ever grasped anyone's feet in this kind of way. But this would have been a very natural response for them. It's the kind of thing that someone might have done for a king, in the same way that we might bow or curtsy before royalty. So these women, they recognize his greatness and they submit to him. They hold him in the highest esteem, and so they are willing to serve him, even to carry out this task of telling others. Worship requires us to do that. In recognizing Jesus's greatness, we then submit to him and serve him. The challenge for us in all this is that it requires us to humble ourselves. And that's a hard thing to do. We are used to running our own lives. We're used to being in charge. We are the kings and queens of our own lives. But this kind of worship, it recognizes that Jesus is greater than we are, that he knows better than we do how to live our own lives. It chooses to no longer be on the throne of our own lives, but to have Jesus sat there at the throne of our lives. And it requires us to do as he would have us do, rather than how we want to live our lives. Now, that's a challenging thing, particularly because we live in an age that tells us to do whatever makes ourselves happy. But this kind of worship, it requires us to humble ourselves and give our lives over to another person, recognizing how great he is. But this is not just letting anyone take charge. This is letting someone take charge who overcame our greatest fear, death, to bring us new life in himself. This is one who died to bring our forgiveness with God and who demonstrated it by coming back to life again. So this Easter, I want to invite you to come and participate in the Easter event, that is the death and resurrection of Jesus. Enter into this true story and make it your own experience. For those of us who belong to the church, this has been our own experience. We're all from different backgrounds, different ways that we've been brought up. But each one of us has known a time in our lives when we have entered into the story of Jesus, where we recognize that his death was for us and that our new life is in him and his new life. We have entered in to be amazed. We have found comfort in Jesus and we have become his worshippers. We have found in him a hope that is greater than our greatest fear. And this can be your experience as well. To become a Christian is to know that you're in deep need of forgiveness and to come feeling sorry for all your sin. It's to come accepting that Jesus died so that you could have all of your sin taken away and that he came back to life so that you could be made new in him now and anticipate a future beyond death in the new creation. Perhaps you want to enter into this journey. If so, then pray and express that to God. As I pray, as I lead us in prayer, if you want to become a Christian, then pray this in your own heart. Submit yourself to Jesus and become one of his worshippers. Let me pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you came to this earth so that you could live a perfect life that we have failed to live, so that you could die on our behalf to bring about our forgiveness, and so that you could come back to life so that we could know a new life in you. Lord, we are people who have sinned, people who have kept God out of our lives, and so we're sorry for that. But we thank you for that forgiveness that you offer us. May we take that forgiveness now and know it in our own hearts. Lord, would you bring us to new life in yourself by your resurrection power? And may we give our lives over to you as your worshippers, as those that will submit to you and serve you. So help us to be those that belong to you. Grant us your mercy and your grace. For Jesus' sake we pray. Amen. Well, let's sing one more Easter song and then I'll come to a close.